Unfortunately, having a problem with your thyroid gland is very common. Whether you have hyperthyroid, hypothyroid, or even just normal thyroid function, it's still common to end up getting what's called thyroid eye disease. And what really sucks is a lot of medical doctors and even eye care professionals just overlook a lot of these signs. And so thyroid eye disease often goes underdiagnosed. And so today we're going to review the 7 signs of thyroid eye disease. Let's take a look. Hey, what's up? Dr. Joseph Allen here from the Dr. Eye Health Show. And on this channel, we help people learn all about eye diseases, glasses, contacts, LASIK, and everything in between. So if you like learning about the eyes, hit the subscribe button. Happy to have you join us. Now, the first thing that we have to mention about thyroid eye disease is the fact that you can have thyroid problems affecting your eyes with any level of thyroid dysfunction. Most people do end up having hyperthyroid, especially in the case of an autoimmune condition called Graves' disease. And most commonly, when eye doctors or anybody in the medical field thinks of anything wrong with the thyroid affecting the eyes, they're usually thinking of Graves' disease. However, even though about 80% of all cases of thyroid eye disease is affected with someone with a hyperthyroid, about 10% of people with hypothyroid or really low thyroid levels, they can still get this. And even people with euthyroid having normal thyroid levels can still end up getting a thyroid eye disease. So again, this is something that not only eye doctors, but even medical doctors should be watching for. Now, the first sign we often see for someone that is developing a problem with the thyroid affecting the eyes is that of eyelid retraction. And this occurs about 80% of these people who are diagnosed. Now, eyelid retraction usually results in people having kind of this alarmed-like stare. In fact, we'll call it scleral show, if you've ever heard that term. And that's when, normally, just looking at somebody, the top of their eyelid should come below the top portion of their cornea. You should not see the white sclera above their cornea there. If you're able to just in normal conversation and they're not giving a surprised look and you're able to see that white part above the cornea, that usually may be a sign that they have this. In fact, in the eye clinic with my students that I teach, I usually try to encourage them to do a test for something called lid lag. And that's where I'll have the patient either follow my fingers or a pen, and I'll have them slowly look up and then look down, look up and look down. We'll do that several times. Now, lid lag is in fact something that's static. So when I'm having them look down, I'm comparing right and left eye because things with thyroid conditions are often asymmetric. And so one eye may have more proptosis or bulging than another. And so when looking in a down gaze, lid lag is in fact where one eyelid will be higher than the other in comparison. And so it's easier to tell just which eye maybe has more scleral show than the other. And that's found in about 50% of all people who have some level of eyelid retraction. Now, the reason I have patients kind of follow my finger looking up and down is in fact so I can see the dynamic part of it, which is the Van Graaff sign. So I'm not just looking if one eye is above the other, but in fact one eyelid is falling down slower than the other, and that's more, again, a more of a movement dynamic appearance, and we call that Van Graaff sign. In my experience, Van Graaff sign's a little bit more difficult to detect, but it's still something to always be observing for. Now, the second sign of thyroid eye disease is that of proptosis, or the medical term called exophthalmos, and that's where the eyeball basically kind of bulges outward toward you, and it's probably the most common thing that medical professionals or eye care doctors are going to think about in their head when they think of somebody who has like Graves' disease or any problem with their thyroid. And the reason that the eyeballs kind of have this bulging like appearance, like they're getting pushed out of the skull, is because the eye muscles that surround the eye are in fact becoming inflamed and swollen due to this problem with the thyroid. It's not fully understood, but something with the antibodies that are basically attacking the thyroid also have a very similar receptor of the eye muscles, and that causes the eye muscles to swell up and even become somewhat fibrotic. And because there's not enough space within the orbital cavity, it basically pushes on the eyeball and then the eyeballs bulge outward. And this is a really fundamental thing to understand because of how the eye muscles get involved. That's basically what ends up causing all the problems with thyroid eye disease to begin with. But even though this is the most common thing that most medical professionals will be thinking about and looking for, it only affects people about 60% of all the cases diagnosed with thyroid eye disease. And to be honest, when I see people who have this type of appearance, yeah, we're gonna order a thyroid panel just to do our due diligence, but you almost don't even need to. You can just tell that person's got thyroid eye disease and possibly Graves' disease from like down the hallway. Now, the third sign of thyroid eye disease is in fact something that I run across all the time as an eye care professional, and that's diplopia or double vision. And this happens because of restrictive orbital myopathy. And this is, again, those eye muscles becoming swollen, and then the proteins inside the eye muscle more or less becoming somewhat fibrotic, and that means the eye muscles can't really move. Something that's interesting that eye doctors have to learn in school is that usually the inferior recti muscles are first involved with thyroid conditions, followed by the medial recti, or the ones toward the nose, followed by the superior, and then the temporal muscles. And this is significant because the type of diplopia that ends up being result. Because the inferior recti muscles are usually involved first, that's why we end up seeing people with vertical diplopia. And someone will come in all of a sudden and they'll feel like, wow, you know, like I'm seeing double up and down with both eyes, and they feel like they need to kind of turn their head one direction to try to correct for it. And then followed up by people who have the medial recti muscles that are kind of stuck in that position, they end up with something called an esotropia, where basically one eye is basically kind of cocked inward and the other eye is looking straight ahead, but then they see double more side to side. Now, the fourth sign of thyroid eye disease is somewhat related to this eye muscle being entrapped, and that's just pain with eye movement. Now, I know pain with eye movement is kind of a weird symptom to try to describe. It's not like a sharp pain. Most people describe it as a dull, achy pain. Now, the tough thing is that if you really move your eyes in extreme gazes, you can kind of feel a tension back there, and that's not going to be the same thing. Now, usually, these people have much more defined pain in almost any direction they move their eyes, and again, we'll see some subtle diplopia, double vision, or other restriction of the eye muscles. There are other diseases where people have pain with eye movement, and that's usually because the optic nerve head is swollen, and so when the eye muscles move, they pull on the optic nerve, and you can feel a pain that way. In this case, this has to do more with the eye muscles being restrictive and having more difficult time moving, so that's the type of pain we're talking about here. But still an important thing that eye care professionals have to consider when somebody maybe has a thyroid problem. Now, number five on our list is, in fact, dry eyes, and this perplexes a lot of people, and I think a lot of eye doctors overlook thyroid conditions as possibly being involved with any form of dry eye or red eyes. Now, the reason why dry eye symptoms are associated with thyroid eye disease has to do with because those eyes are moving outward and then the eyelids aren't fully closing. So a lot of people will get a lag ophthalmos, where their eyelids just aren't closing all the way, and that leads to what's called exposure keratopathy, meaning the eyeballs is exposed to the air and then their tears are evaporating. That's leaving behind salt content, and then the surface of the eye ends up getting damaged and kind of like eroded away. More specifically, there is a condition called SLK, or superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis, and that's where during an examination, I will often ask my patients to look down, and then I'll flip the upper eyelid and look underneath that eyelid on the white part of the eye, on the sclera, and we expect it to be nice and white. But if it looks more red and irritated in the symptoms of dry eye, then it could perhaps be this SLK condition. And in cases of superior limbic keratoconjunctivitis, or this SLK, they are associated with thyroid eye disease, largely because, again, that top eyelid is just not retracting correctly and is rubbing more on that top part of the eye. But it's not uncommon for myself or my other colleagues to detect this and start questioning, hey, does this person have some sort of a thyroid condition? And do we maybe need to order labs or talk to their family doctor and get things checked out? Now, here on this channel, we have also done a lot of videos on dry eye treatment specifically. If you're having dry eye symptoms and just want to know more about what could all be going on, I have a complete playlist for that, and I'll put that in the description below that like button so you can find that easily. Otherwise, I know a lot of people with dry eye symptoms and issues like this also often have kind of a red eye appearance, and that also goes hand in hand with thyroid conditions as well. And that really falls down to our sixth sign of thyroid eye disease, and that is edema, including chemosis, kind of a swelling, gelatinous appearance to the surface of the eye, along with redness that appears on kind of the 9 and 3 o'clock positions of the eye. And again, that all has to do with that same thing. The eyes are coming outward, eyelids aren't closing completely, and that leaves exposure and inflammatory proteins to kind of accumulate on the eye, even inflammation coming from the eye recti muscles that could be leading to kind of a redness, pink sides of the eye. But they're definitely more pronounced, again, at that 3 and 9 o'clock positions. And finally, number 7 is that of optic neuropathy. And thankfully, this only occurs in about 6% of individuals who have a thyroid problem. Now, what is going on is that because the eye muscles are swelling up and they're becoming rigid, and there's no real space for the eyeball to go, the optic nerve gets compressed by these eye muscles. And this can be really concerning to all eye care professionals, because when the optic nerve is being pushed on, there's the risk that it's going to be permanently damaged. And so people with these thyroid issues, they can end up losing parts of their visual field. And this doesn't happen very rapidly, at least usually. It's usually a slow process. And so people don't notice it going on. But that means that people, unfortunately, can go blind from thyroid dysfunction. They can have permanent vision loss if it's not caught fast enough. But again, that's why, thankfully, it's only about 6% of cases, but still something that we don't want to ignore. Now, thankfully, for most people who have a thyroid problem, they're working with their family doctor and they're getting their numbers checked, they're getting on treatment, and we don't see a huge advancement in thyroid eye disease. But some people, unfortunately, do still progress. So it's something that eye care professionals need to be watching for, and even medical professionals need to be aware that this exists. The other more recent and cool thing is that, at least as far as treatment goes, when someone does have these severe forms of proptosis or their eyelids being involved, we can do what's called orbital decompression surgery. That's kind of the end stage thing. Most eye doctors actually prefer to try to avoid needing that, because that's where we have to remove bone and sometimes the fat around the eyes to make more room for the eyes to sit correctly. Or now we have a new medication that's been FDA approved called Tepezza. It's always tough to sometimes know how these are supposed to be pronounced. But this is a new treatment that has been found to be significant at reducing the proptosis of the eyes. So again, the sooner we're able to catch things and get treatment going, the better. But hey, if you're watching this and you have concerns that maybe you've got one or multiple signs of this and your doctors have never really measured your eyes for proptosis, that they're sticking out of your eye, or maybe you've never had your thyroid levels checked, then certainly talk with your eye care professional, talk with your family doctor, seeing if you can get labs drawn, and just to make sure things are doing okay. One of the things I love is how my patients are strong advocates for their own health, and I'm glad that you're here watching this and being part of this family. We all need to take better care of ourselves. So kudos to you for remaining curious and taking good care of yourself. Hey, otherwise, thanks for watching. If you learned something new, go ahead and hit that like button for me and drop a comment in the section below if you have questions more about thyroid eye disease, Graves' disease, anything going on with the surface of the eye. I love hearing your questions and being able to comment with you and maybe even make future videos based on your comments and suggestions. Otherwise, until next time, keep an eye on it. We'll see you soon.